Assalamualaikum and a very good evening to all my classmates and Ahmad Shazi. Today we are presenting about Chapter 9, Global Human Resource Management. This is going to be a long video by the way. Let me introduce you to our group members, which is just the two of us. My name is Nur Amira Izlin binti Ahmad Zabidi and my other group member's name is Suhaimi bin Abu Sama. There are 11 subtopics. The first one is the importance of international human resources. Second, sources of human resources. Third, selection criteria for international assignment. Fourth, economic pressure and trends in expert assignment. Fifth, international human resources selection procedure. Followed by the 6.0, compensation. 7.0, individual and host country viewpoint. 8.0, repatriation of expatriate. 9.0, training in international management. 10.0, types of training program. And lastly, 11.0, cultural assimilators.
Okay, assalamualaikum. Now I would like to tell you the importance of international human resources. Human resource management is key to an efficient and productive workplace. By focusing on the employees or the human resources themselves, organizations have found that positive organizational structure leads to company success in the market, such as competitive salaries, good benefits, promotions, training, education opportunities, and so forth. Next, getting the employee perspective. Understanding how employees feel they are being treated is important to increase productivity or decrease turnover rates. Retention and commitment to the organization is achieved by focusing on employees and tailoring human resource management to the individual. Next is employees as critical resources. Success of firms depends on attracting the most qualified employees and matching them to the jobs for which they are best suited. Face-to-face human contact remains an important means of communication and transferring tacit knowledge, which is a knowledge that can be formalized in manuals or written guidelines. Next is investing in international assignments. Sending employees overseas can be expensive. Investment in recruiting and training is required to gain higher caliber of people. The emergence of highly trained technical and scientific employees in emerging markets and the increased prevalence of MBA-type training in many developed and developing countries have dramatically expanded the pool of talent from which MNCs can draw. Next is economic pressures. Nature of the human resources process is changing as a result of ongoing pressures of reduced costs and increased efficiencies. Pay freezes or reductions along with hiring freezes were quite common during global recession. Employees expressed concern over long-term talent retention during the global recession. Organizations reserved their salary increases and cash reward for their most talented and top-performing employees, while pay is cut for the rest of the workforce. Next, sources for human resources. Let's analyze MNC's four basic sources for positions and in addition of other potential sources. First is home country nationals, host country nationals, third country nationals, impatriates, and other potential sources such as subcontracting and offshore outsourcing. First, I will explain the home country nationals. Managers who are citizens of the country where the MNC is headquartered. They are called headquarters national or expatriates. Local managers were most effective in subsidiaries located in developing countries or those that relied on a local customer base. Expatriates were most effective when they were in charge of larger subsidiaries. Or those with a marketing team similar to that at headquarters. The reasons to use home country nationals are start up operations, provide technical expertise, develop promising managers, facilitate coordination and control. And the other reasons to use home country nationals are the unavailability of managerial talent in the host country, the company's view for the foreign operation as short-lived, the host country's multiracial population, which might mean that selecting a manager of either race would result in political or social problems, the company's conviction that it must maintain a foreign image in the host country, the belief of some companies that a home country manager is the best person for the job. And these are the reasons not to use home country nationals. First, cost, uncertain return, increasing availability of host country, and third country nationals, impatriates. Next is host country nationals. There are local managers hired by the MNC. Reasons to use host country nationals. Countries expect the MNC to hire local talent and to cut costs of transferring and maintaining host country personnel. For example, Sony is trying the host country approach in the United States. Sony believes that local citizens are the best qualified for the job as opposed to Japanese managers because they already have a working knowledge of the language and culture, and it may be difficult for Sony to understand preferred styles otherwise. Next is third country nationals. Managers who are citizens of countries other than the country in which MNC is headquartered, managers are assigned to work by the MNC. The advantages of using third country nationals, salary and benefit package is less than that of a home country national. Good working knowledge of the region of familiarity with a local language. Other cited benefits of using third country nationals are achieve corporate objectives is more effective than with expatriates or local nationals. They frequently have a deep understanding of the corporation's policies from the perspective of foreigner and can communicate and implement those policies more effectively to others than can expats. Substitute for expatriates and offer new perspectives to viewpoints of local nationals and headquarters personnel during rapid expansion. Also offer different perspectives that can complement and expand on the narrowly focused viewpoints of local nationals and headquarters personnel. It is also possible to demonstrate a global or transnational image and bring unique cross-cultural skills to the relationship in joint ventures. For example, Gillette, Coca-Cola, and IBM recruit local managers and train them to run overseas subsidiaries. Impatriates. So what is impatriates? It's an opposite of expatriates, which is individuals from a host country or third country who are assigned to work in the home country. And they are called impats. Japanese MNCs rely on impatriates to help them meet their international challenges by reducing their unicultural orientation businesses. Yoichi Morishita, president of Matsushita, has ordered that top management must reflect the cultural diversity of the countries where Matsushita does business. Help MNCs to develop their global core competencies. Global managers or transnational managers are now emerging and are part of a growing group of international executives who can manage across borders and do not fit the traditional third country nationals mold. Next is subcontracting and outsourcing. Offshore outsourcing, increasing organizational and technological capacity of companies to separate, coordinate, and integrate geographical dispersed human resources. Service industries are exploiting inexpensive telecommunications to transmit engineering, service, medical, legal, and accounting services to be performed in locations previously viewed as remote. Presents significant opportunities for cost savings, lower overhead, and access to qualified personnel. In an age of cheap communications, almost any job can be performed in India for a fraction of US wages. The wage savings do not necessarily translate directly to overall savings because the typical outsourcing contract between an American company and an Indian vendor saves less than half as much as the wage differences would imply. Politically controversial, union groups, politicians, and NGOs have challenged MNC's right to engage in labor arbitrage. Outsourcing can save companies significant costs and is very profitable for firms that specialize in providing these services on a contract basis. Can create quality control problems. British Telecom's giant BT's decision in 2016 to repatriate some of its call center staff from India to the UK due to the quality control problems. Tool for managing and deploying international human resources. Subcontracting provides important flexibility in the human resource practices of the MNCs operating globally. Requires skilled international managers to coordinate and oversee the complex relationships that arise from it. Next is selection criteria for international assignments. The national selection criteria factors used to choose international managers. These selections are influenced by the MNC's experience and often are culturally based. First is general criteria, adaptability to cultural change, physical and emotional health, age, experience and education, language training, motivation for a foreign assignment, spouse and family adaptability, and leadership ability. The first is general criteria. The list of criteria when choosing personnel are technical criteria, human criteria. Firms that fail to consider both often find that their rate of failure is quite high. Japanese and American MNCs in their survey ranked both technical expertise and interpersonal skills as very important. Next is adaptability to cultural change. Able to adapt to change and a degree of cultural toughness. Greater contact with host nationals helps with cultural adjustment when the person also possesses the personality trait of openness. Sociability was directly related to effective adjustment. The characteristics are work experience with other cultures, previous overseas travel, knowledge of foreign language, and heritage. Next is physical and emotional health. Great physical conditions with no heart condition or nervous order, able to withstand culture shock. For example, one US oil company operating in the Middle East considers middle-aged men with grown children to be best able to cope with culture shock. Next is age, experience and education. Balance between age and experience, many firms send both young and seasoned personnel to the same overseas post and gives specific training designed to help them deal more effectively with the types of problems they will face on the job. Next is language training. Ability to speak the language of the country in which a manager is doing business. For many expatriates, being able to speak with locals in their own language is a major milestone in finally feeling connected to the foreign country. This is especially important for countries like Russia, where successful integration is heavily dependent on being able to converse in Russian. And next is motivation for a foreign assignment. Chances of promotion and improved economic status. Many US MNCs regard international experience as being critical for promotion to the upper ranks. And thanks to the supplemental wage and benefit package, US managers sometimes find that they can make, especially save, more money than if they remain stateside. Spouse and family adaptability. If family is not happy, the manager often performs poorly and may either be terminated or simply decide to leave the organization. Sheffer and her associates recently collected multi-source data from 334 expatriates, feels he or she is receiving, and the interplay between the person's work and family domains have a direct and unique influence on the individual's intentions regarding staying with or leaving the enterprise. Adaptability screening, the process of evaluating how well a family is likely to stand up to the stress of overseas life. The company will look for a number of things in this screening, including how closely knit the family is, withstands stress and adjusts to a new culture and climate. The reason this family criterion receives so much attention is that MNCs have learned that an unhappy executive will be unproductive on the job, and the individual will want to transfer home long before the tour of duty is complete. These findings were affirmed and extended by Bostoff and her associates, who examined the factors associated with employee willingness to work overseas and concluded that unmarried employees are more willing than any other group to accept expat assignments. Married couples without children at home or those with non-teenage children are probably the most willing to move. Prior international experience appears associated with willingness to work as an expatriate. Individuals most committed to their professional careers and to their employing organizations are prone to be more willing to work as expatriates. Careers and attitudes of spouses will likely to have a significant impact on employee willingness to move overseas. Employee and spouse perceptions of organizational support for expatriates are critical to employee willingness to work overseas. These findings indicate that organizations cannot afford to overlook the role of spouse in the expat selection process. Next is leadership ability to influence people to act in a particular way. The characteristics are maturity, emotional stability, good communication, independence, initiative, creativity, and good health. If these characteristics are present and the person has been an effective leader in the home country, MNCs assume that the individual also will do well in overseas. And other considerations, taking certain steps to prepare themselves better for international assignments. Phase 1, focus on self-evaluation and general awareness. And in phase 2, characterized by a concentration on activities that should be completed before a person is selected. Phase 3, activities to be completed after being selected for an overseas assignment. So next is economic pressures and trends in expat assignments. So the objective is to fill a managerial or technical gap, career development and local relationship building. employee benefits, faster promotions, higher pay, stronger performance ratings, and more mobility within the company. Rejected due to family and spouse career concerns. Employee need to improve their familial benefits if they want to decrease assignment rejection. For example, provided assistance to help support elderly family members while employees were away on assignment. Extremely expensive and return on investment is difficult to quantify. 3/4 of the companies surveyed in 2015 stated that they were facing increasing pressure to reduce the overall cost of their expatriate programs. Part of this pressure may be due to the fact that traditional financial metrics, such as return on investment, are not utilized by the overwhelming majority of companies when evaluating the success or failure of their overseas program. The primary objectives of most international assignments are not directly profit-based.
5.0 are international human resource selection procedures. MNC use a number of selection of procedures. The two most common are tests and interview. Some international firms use only one, a smaller percentage employ both. Theoretical models containing the variables that are important for adjusting to an overseas assignment have been developed. These adjustment models can help contribute to more effective selection of expatriate. The following section examine traditional testing and viewing and interviewing procedures and then present an adjustment model. 5.1 Testing and interviewing procedures. Some evidence suggests that although some firms use testing, but it is not extremely popular. For example, an early study found that almost 80% of 127 foreign operation managers who were surveyed reported that their companies use no test in the selection process. This contrasts with the more widespread testing that this firm use when selecting domestic managers. Many MNC reports that the cost, questionable accuracy, and poor predictive record make testing of limited value. Many firms use to interview to screen people for overseas assignment. One expert notes, it is generally agreed that extensive interview of candidates and their spouse by senior executives still ultimately provide the best method of selection. Tom's research support this comment. For example, 52% of the US MNCs she surveyed reported that in the case of managerial candidates, MNC conducted interview with both the managers and his or her spouse, and 47% conducted interviews with the candidate alone. Learning this finding, Tung concluded, it suggests that in management-type positions, which involve more extensive contract with the local community, as compared to technically-oriented positions, the adaptability of the spouse to living in a foreign environment was perceived as important for successful performance abroad. However, even for technically-oriented position, a sizable promotion of the firms did conduct interview with both candidate and spouse. This lends support to the contention of other researchers that MNCs are becoming increasingly cognizant of the importance of this factor to effective performance abroad. 5.2, the adjustment process. There are two major types of adjustment. These adjustment models help to identify the underpinning of the effective selection of expatriate. There are two major types of adjustment that an expatriate must make when going on an overseas assignment. Okay, first, anticipatory adjustment, carried out before the expat leave for the assignment and is influenced by a number of important notes. One factor is the pre-departure training that is provided. This often takes the form of cross-cultural seminars, of workshop, and it is designed to acquaint expat with the culture and work life of the country to which they will be posted. Another factor affecting anticipatory adjustment is the previous experience that expats may have had with the assigned country or with countries with similar culture. The organizational input into anticipatory adjustment is most directly related and concerned with the selection process. Traditionally, MNCs rely on only one important selection criterion for overseas assignment: technical and competence. Next, in-country adjustment takes place once the expatriate is on site and a number of factors influence his or her ability to adjust effectively. Okay, for the first factors, the expat ability to maintain a positive outlook in the face of a high-pressure situation, to interact well with host national, and to perceive and evaluate the host country cultural values and norms correctly. Job itself, as reflected by the clarity of the role the expat in the host management team, the authority the expat has to make decisions, the newness of the work-related challenges, and the amount of role conflict that exists, organizational culture, and how easily the expat can adjust to it. Non-work matters, such as the toughness with which the expatriate faces a whole new cultural experience and how well his or her family can adjust to the rigors of the assignments. Identify in the adjustment models is the expert ability to develop effective socialization tactic and to understand what's and who's in the host organization. Five stages process. Another model of expatriate adjustment emphasizes the formation of network ties in the host country to obtain critical informational and emotional support resources. Promoting a five stage process models that delineates how expatriate from form adjustment facilitating support ties in a culturally unfamiliar context. This include stage 1, factors influencing expatriate motivation to seek support from actors in the host country. Stage 2, factors influencing expatriate selection of and support seeking towards actors. Stage 3, factors influencing contacted actors' ability and willingness to provide support. Stage 4, factors influencing expatriates' utilization of received support. Stage 5, factors influencing expatriate addition of actors to network. These anticipatory and in-country factors will influence the expatriate mode and degree of adjustment to an overseas assignment. They can help to explain why effective solution of expatriate is multifaceted and can be very difficult and challenging. But if all works out well, the individual can become a very important part of the organization overseas operation. The relocation transition curve. McCormick and Chapman illustrated this by showing the changes that an expat goes through as he or she seeks to adjust to the new assignment. As seen in the figure, early earthquakeism often gives way to co-reality, and the expat typically ends up in a search to balance personal and work demands with the new environment. In many cases, fortunately, everything works out well. Additionally, one of the ways in which MNC often try to put potential expat at ease about their new assignment is by presenting an attractive compensation package. Okay, next, cost of living index. One of the reasons there has been a decline in the number of expats in recent years in MNC have found that the expense can be prohibitive. On average, expat cost employees 2 to 5 times as much as home country counterparts and frequently 10 or more times as much as local national in the host country to which they are assigned. As seen in the figure, the cost of living in some of the major cities is extremely high, and these expenses must be included somewhere in the compensation package. Recession of late 2000s placed additional pressure on firms to control costs associated with expatriate assignment. In 2009, that nearly 40% of MNC were planning on revising their current international assignment policy. In the face of declining corporate growth and profitability as well as an uncertain economic environment, this increasing trend towards localization reflects companies' effort to either tap into the local talents or to offer less generous packages to locally hired foreign workers. This localization approach was quite consistent among regions and countries around the world, including for companies operating in emerging markets such as China, India, and Vietnam, where the local compensation and benefit packages are less generous than home country plans. In terms of expatriate benefits and allowance, the elements that are least likely to be eliminated for localized employees are housing allowance and education benefits. 6.1, common element of compensation packages, 6.1.1, base salary, amount of money that an expatriate receives in their home country. In US, this has often been in range $200,000 to $300,000 for upper middle managers in recent years. This rate is similar to that paid to managers in both Japan and Germany. The exchange rates also affect the real wages. Expatriate salaries typically are set according to the base pay of the home countries. German managers working for US MNC and assigned to Spain will have a base salary that reflects the salary structure in Germany. US expatriate have salaries tied to US level. Their salaries usually are paid in home currency, local currency, or a combination of the two. The base pay also serves as benchmark against which bonus and benefits are calculated. 6.1.2, benefits, one-third of compensation for regular employees. These benefits compose a similar, even larger portion of expat compensation. A number of thorny issues surround compensation for expatriate, however. These include, first, whether MNC should maintain expatriate in home country benefits program, particularly if these programs are not tax deductible. Second, whether MNC has have the option of enrolling expatriate in host country benefit programs or making up any difference in coverage. Third, whether host country legislation regarding termination of employment affect employee benefit entitlement. Fourth, whether the home or host country is responsible for the expatriate social security benefits. And fifth, whether the home or host country is responsible for the expatriate social security benefits. Which country should pay for the benefits, whether other benefits should be used to offset any shortfall in coverage, and lastly, whether home country benefits program should be available to local national. Most US MNC include expatriate managers in their home office benefits program at no additional cost to the expat. If the host country requires expat to contribute to their social security program, MNC typically will pick up the tab. Several international agreements between countries recently have eliminated such dual coverage and expenses. Additionally, MNC often provide expatriate with extra vacation and with special leave. MNC typically will pay the airfare for expat and their families to make an annual visit home, for emergency leave, and for expenses when a relative in the home country is ill or died. 6.1.3 Allowance, expensive feature of expatriate compensation packages. Most common part is a cost of living allowance, which is payment for difference between home country and overseas assignment. Designed to provide the expat with the same standard of living that he or she enjoyed in the home country. May cover a variety of expenses including relocation, housing, education, and hardship. Okay, next, example of allowance. First, relocation expenses involve moving, shipping, and storage charge that are associated with personal furniture, clothing, and other items that expatriate and the family are or are not taking to the new assignment. Includes cars and club membership in host country. These perks commonly are provided only to senior level expat. Okay, second, housing allowance. Cover a wide range. Some firms provide the expat with a residence during the assignment and pay all associated expenses. Others give a predetermined housing allotment each month and let expat choose their own residence. Some NMC help those going on assignment with the sale or lease of the house they are leaving behind. If the house is sold, company usually pay closing costs and other associated expenses. Third, education expenses for the expat children are another integral part of the compensation package. Cover cost tuition, enrollment fees, books, supplies, transportation, room, board and school uniforms. Some cases, expenses to attend post-secondary schools also covered. Lastly, hardship allowance to induce expat to work in hazardous areas or in area with poor quality of life. Those who are assigned to Eastern Europe, China and some Middle Eastern countries sometimes are granted a hardship premium. This payment may be in the form of a lump sum or a percentage of the expat-based compensation. 6.1.4 Incentive. Some MNC have also been designing special incentive program for keeping expat motivated. In the process, a growing number of firms have dropped the ongoing premium for overseas assignment and replaced it with one-time lump sum premium. For example, in the early 1990s, over 60% of MNC give ongoing premium to their expat. Today, that percentage is under 50% and continuing to decline. Peterson and his colleague examined the human resource policies of 24 US, British, German and Japanese subsidiaries and found that in only 10 cases did the multinational have a policy of paying expatriate higher compensation than they will have received if they had stayed in the home country. Lump sum payment has a number of benefits. First, expat realize that they will given this payment just once when they move to the international local, so the payment tends to retain its value as an incentive. The cost to the company are less because there is only one payment and no future financial commitment. It is a separate payment, distinguishable for regular pay. It is more readily available for saving or spending. Okay, next, specific incentive program that is used will vary aspect like this. Researchers found that some of the factors that influence the types and amount of incentive include whether the person is moving within or between continents and where the person is being stationed. It is important to recognize that growing number of MNC are beginning to phase out incentive premiums. They are focusing on creating a cut of expat who are motivated by non-financial incentive. In the table provides some of the latest survey information related to worldwide employer incentive practice. 6.1.5 Tax. Another major component of expatriate compensation is tax equalization. An expat may have two tax bills, one from the host country and one from the US Internal Revenue Service for the same pay. IRS Code Section 911 permits a deduction of up to $100,800 on foreign earned income. Top level expat often earn far more than this. They may pay two tax bills for the amount by which their pay exceed. MNCs pay extra tax burden. Most common way is by determining base salary and other extras that the expat will make if based in the home country. They are computed and compared with the tax due on the expat income. Tax that exceed what will have been imposed in the home country are paid by the MNC, and any windfall is kept by the expat as a reward for taking the assignment. 6.2 Tailoring the package. Working within the five common elements just described, MNC will tailor compensation package to fit in the specific situation. Example, senior level managers in Japan are paid only around 4 times as much junior staff members. This is in sharp contrast to US, where the multiple is much higher. Similar situation exists in Europe, where many senior level managers make far less than their US counterparts, and stockholders, politicians and general public oppose US style affluence. One solution is to link pay and performance to attract and retain outstanding personnel. In formulating compensation package, a number of approaches can be used. Okay, first, the most common is balance sheet approach, an approach to developing an expatriate compensation package that ensure the expat is made whole and does not lose money by taking the assignment. A second and often complementary approach is negotiation, which involves working out a special and ad hoc arrangement that is acceptable to both the company and the expat. Third approach, localization, an approach to developing an expatriate compensation package that involves paying the expat a salary comparable to that of local national. This approach most commonly is used with individuals early in their careers who are being given a long-term overseas assignment. Okay, fourth, lump sum method, an approach to developing an expatriate compensation package that involves giving the expat a predetermined amount of money and letting the individual make his or her own decision regarding how to spend it. Fifth, is cafeteria approach, an approach to developing an expatriate compensation package that entails giving the individual a series of options and letting the person decide how to spend the available fund. For example, expats who have children may opt for private schooling, who have no children may choose a cafeteria-driven car or an upscale apartment. A sixth method is regional system, an approach to developing an expatriate compensation package that involves setting a compensation system for all expats who are assigned to a particular region and paying everyone in accord with that system. For example, everyone going to Europe falls under one particular system, and everyone being assigned to South America is covered by a different system. The most important things to remember about global compensation is that package must be co-effective and fair. If it meets these two criteria, it will likely will be acceptable to all parties. As a result, 2008 to 2010 recession, many companies are making changes to their expatriate staffing and compensation practice. While many companies have developed short-term assignment and business travel policies to more efficiently fill their staffing needs, more comprehensive measures such as shifting home country employees working in foreign locations from expatriate to local plus package are becoming more common. Participants in two surveys of HR consultancy report a growing trend expatriate-like or local plus package. This alternative package often beats the assignee salary on host country pay structures. 7.0 individual and host country viewpoint. Two additional perspectives for selection warrant consideration. Okay, first, that of the individual who is being selected. Second, that of the country to which the candidate will be sent. Research shows that each has specific desire and motivations regarding the expatriate selection process. 7.1 candidate motivations, greater demand for their talents abroad than at home. For example, growing number of senior US managers have moved to Mexico because of Mexico growing need for experienced executive. The findings of one early study group the participating countries into cluster. Within this grouping, researchers were able to identify major motivational differences. Okay, for the first group, Anglo consists of Australia, Austria, Canada, India, New Zealand, South Africa, Switzerland, United Kingdom and United States. For the second group, Northern European consists of Denmark, Finland and Norway. Third, French consists of Belgium and France. Fourth, Northern South American consists of Colombia, Mexico and Peru. Fifth, Southern South America consists of Argentina and Chile. And lastly, independent, which is Brazil, Germany, Israel, Japan, Sweden and Venezuela. Some of their findings included, first, the Anglo cluster was more interested in individual achievement and less interested in the desire for security than any other cluster. The French cluster was similar to the Anglo cluster, except that less importance was given to the individual achievement and more to security. noted, countries in the Northern European cluster were more oriented to job accomplishment and less to getting ahead. Considerable importance was assigned to jobs not interfering with personal life. Fourth, in South American clusters, individual achievements goals were less important than in most other clusters. Fringe benefits were particularly important to South American groups. Fifth, Germans were similar to those in the South American cluster, except that they placed a greater emphasis on advancement and earnings. And lastly, the Japanese were unique in their mix of desire. They place high value on challenge, but now on autonomy. At the same time, they place strong emphasis on working in a friendly, efficient department and having good physical working conditions. Another interesting focus on attention has been on those countries that expatriate like best. Found that 1,100 Swedish expatriates surveyed were at least fairly well satisfied with their host country, and in some cases were very satisfied. Five countries that they liked very much were Switzerland, Belgium, England, US and Portugal. These countries are still popular today, which makes sense because they are included in the top of countries with highest quality of life. The criteria include such as family life, economic life, unemployment rates, political stability and so forth. 7.2 Host country desire. Many MNC try to choose people who fit in well. Little attention has been paid to the host country's point of view. Behavior can distinguish them from one another, and that host countries will prefer a managerial style similar to that of their country. For example, positive managerial behaviors such as honesty and follow through with employees distinguish Indonesian and US managers from Mexican managers. Negative managerial behaviors such as public criticism and discipline towards employees also distinguish Indonesian and US managers from Mexican managers. It has been suggested that the dynamic in the workplace has to do with the familial structure, namely that Mexican workers place a higher value on family over work than do their US or Indonesian in country. This can be a factor in how the positive and negative behaviors are expressed in each country. It is important for managers to take host country perspective into consideration, or could result in ineffectual endeavor. 8.0 Repatriation of expatriate. Repatriation is the return to one's home country from an overseas management assignment, occurs within 5 years of the time they live. Few expatriates remain overseas for the duration of their stay with the firm. When they return, these expatriates often find themselves facing readjustment problems. Some MNC are trying to deal with this problem through use of transition strategy. 8.1 Reasons for returning. The most common reason that expatriates return home from overseas assignment is that first, they are formally agreed on tour duty is over. Before they left, the expatriate was told that they will be posted overseas for a predetermined period, often 2 to 3 years, and they are returned as planned. This is considered a successfully completed assignment. According to a 2015 study, 94% of all expatriate assignments were complete as intended. Through infrequent, early returns do occur. The most common reason, accounting for 23% of all terminated assignments, is because family concerns. This encompasses a variety of issues common to many expatriate families, including spouse who have difficulty acclimating to a new culture and expatriate who want their children educated in a home country school. The second most common reason for expatriate to return early is due to company restructuring. This is because business opportunities change rapidly and the usefulness of an overseas assignment might decline if a company change strategy. In this instance, expatriate may have had every intent, on staying and completing his or her full assignment. Okay, next, common fears that expatriate and their families have before embarking on an overseas assignment really pose an issue once the expatriate arrive in the host country. For example, only 3% of all field assignments were due to security concerns, and just 5% of expatriates faced cultural challenges that resulted in an early leave. MNC have continually improved their selection process of suitable employees for expatriate. As a result, overwhelming majority of international assignments succeed. 8.2 Readjustment problems. Many companies that say they want their people to have international experience often seem unsure of what to do with these managers after their return. One recent survey of mid-size and large firms found that 80% of these companies send people abroad, and more than half of them intend to increase the number they have on assignments overseas. However, responses from returning expats point to problems. Okay, next, 3/4 of the respondents said that they felt their permanent position upon returning home was a demotion. Second, over 60% said that they lacked the opportunity to put their foreign experience to work. And over 60% said that their company had not communicated clearly about what will happen to them when they are returned. Perhaps worst of all, within a year of returning, 25% of the managers had left the company. These statistics are not surprising to those who have been studying repatriation problems. Next, other readjustment problems are more personal in nature. Many expatriates find that salary and fringe benefits assignment now are lost, and adjusting to this lower standard of living is difficult. In addition, those who sold their houses and now must buy the new ones find that the monthly cost often is much higher than when they left. The children often are placed in public school where classes are much larger than in the overseas private school. Many also miss the cultural lifestyle, as in the case of an executive who is transferred from Paris, France to a medium-sized city in US, from any developed country to underdeveloped country. Additionally, many returning expatriates have learned that their international experience are not viewed as important. Many Japanese expatriates report that when they return, their experience should be downplayed if they want to fit in with the organization. Other research support that the findings note here and offers operative recommendation for action. Based on the questionnaire completed by 174 respondents who had been repatriated from four large US MNC, Black found that first, individuals whose expectations were met had the most positive level of repatriation adjustment and job performance. In high-level managers, expatriate job demands were greater rather than less than expected reported high level. Okay, third, job performance and adjustment greater for individual whose job constraint expectation under met than for those individual over met. Living and housing conditions turn out to be better than expected. General repatriation adjustment and job performance were better. And lastly, individual whose expectation were met on over met had job evaluation that placed 10% higher than those were unmet. 8.3 Transition strategies to help smooth the adjustment from an overseas to a stateside assignment. Some NMC have developed transition strategies which can take a number of different forms. One is the use of repatriation agreements whereby the firm agrees with the individual the duration of overseas posting and promise to give the individual on return a job that is mutually acceptable. This agreement typically does not promise a specific position or salary, but the agreement may state that the person will be given the job that is equal to, if not better than the one held before leaving. Some firms rent or maintain expatriate homes until their return. The Aluminium Company of America and Union Carbide both have such plans for managers going overseas. This plan helps reduce the financial shock that often accompanies home shopping by returning expatriate. A third strategy to use senior executive as sponsor of managers abroad. Okay, next, still another push is to keep expatriate managers apprised of what is going on at corporate headquarters and to plug these managers into projects at the home office whenever they are on leave in their home country. This helps maintain the person visibility and ensures the individual is looked on as a regular member of the management staff. Some of the main problems of repatriation, first, adjusting to life back home. Second, facing a financial package that is not as good as that overseas. Third, having less autonomy in the stateside job than in the overseas position. Fourth, not receiving any career counselling from the company. Some additional steps suggested by experts in this area included, first, arranging an event to welcome and recognize the employee and family. Second, establishing support to facilitate family reintegration. Third, offering repatriation counseling or workshop to ease the adjustment. Assisting the spouse with the counseling, resume writing, and interviewing technique. Fifth, providing educational counseling for the children. Providing the employee with a true debriefing by a facilitator, offering international outplacement to the employee and re-entry counselling, and lastly, arranging a post-assignment interview with the expatriate and spouse.
So now is training in international management. Training is the process of altering employee behaviour and attitudes in a way that increases the probability of goal attainment. Training is particularly important in preparing employees for overseas assignment because to ensure that employees' full potential is tapped in overseas assignments, aids in in understanding the customs, cultures, and work habits of the local culture, simplest training, which is placing a cultural integrator in each foreign operation, topics in cultural training, which is social and business etiquette, customs, economics, history, and politics. Next is the impact of overall management philosophy on training. The first philosophy is ethnocentric MNC, stresses nationalism and puts home office people in charge of the international management positions. The MNC headquarters group and the affiliated world company managers all have the same basic experience, attitudes, and beliefs about how to manage operations. Many Japanese firms follow this practice. Next philosophy is polycentric MNC. Places local nationals in key positions and allow these managers to appoint and develop their own people. MNC headquarters gives the subsidiaries managers authority to manage their operations just as long as these operations are sufficiently profitable. Some MNCs use this approach in East Asia, Australia, and other markets that are deemed too expensive to staff with expatriates. Next philosophy is regional-centric MNC. Relies on local managers from a particular geographic region to handle operations in and around that area. A region-centric approach often relies on regional group cooperation of local managers. For example, production facilities in France will be used to produce goods for EU countries. Next philosophy is geocentric MNC. Seeks to integrate diverse regions of the world through a global approach to decision making. Assignments are based on qualifications, and all subsidiary managers throughout the structure are regarded as equal to those at headquarters. IBM is an excellent example of an MNC that attempts to use geocentric approach. The reasons for training. Training programs are useful in preparing people for overseas assignment for many reasons and can be put into two general categories, which is organizational reasons and personal reasons. organizational reasons for training relate to the enterprise at large and its efforts to manage overseas operations more effectively, help to overcome ethnocentrism means belief that one's way of doing things is superior to that of others. Understand the values of other countries when they are transferred overseas. They have better understanding interacting with local personnel. Improve the flow of communication between the home office and the international subsidiaries and branches. Effective communication can help minimize the problems of adequately informed regarding what is expected of them. Increase overall efficiency and profitability. Organizations give their managers global assignments that only filled with technical and managerial needs, but also provided developmental experiences for the personnel. So for personal reasons, it improves overseas managers' ability to interact effectively with local people and their personnel. How to take a client to a dinner, effectively apologize to a customer, appropriately address one overseas colleagues, communicate formally and politely with others, learn how to help others, save face. Dispelling myths and stereotypes by replacing them with facts about cultures. For example, helping expatriates better understand Arab executives. Develop foreign language skills. Deal with arrogance, overruling of decisions and criticism. Many expatriate managers find that their power and prestige are much greater than they were in their job in the home country. Overruling of decisions often seen at lower levels of the hierarchy. Criticism creates bad feelings and lack of loyalty. Improve overall management style. Improve in leadership, decision making, communication, and group work. So next is types of training programs. There are many different types of multinational management training programs. Some last only a few hours, others last 4 months. Some are fairly superficial and others are extensive in coverage. Organizations can decide what training program works best by determining the effectiveness of the program and altering it accordingly. A combination of standardized and tailor-made training and development approaches are used. And standardized versus tailor-made. Some management training is standard or general. For example, participants often are taught how to use specific decision-making tools such as quantitative analysis, and regardless of where the managers are sent in the world, the application is the same. These tools do not have to be culturally specific. Small firms rely on standard training programs. Larger MNCs tend to design their own. Tailor-made training programs are designed for specific needs of the participant, offering input by obtained from managers who currently are working in their country, which participant will be sent and who are citizens in that country. Often designed to provide a new set of skills for a new culture. For example, MNCs are now learning that in managing in China, there is a need to provide directive leadership training because many local managers rely heavily on rules, procedures, and orders from their superiors to guide their behaviors. Offerings are provided before the individuals leave for their overseas assignments. They also post-departure training programs that are conducted on-site, often take form of systematically familiarizing the individual with the country through steps. Training approaches that are successful in one geographic region of the world may need to be heavily modified if they are to be as effective elsewhere. So this human resource management challenges facing MNCs in China. When in employee recruitment, the market for skilled manual and white collar employees is very tight and characterized by rapidly rising wages and high turnover rates. Nepotism and overhiring remain a major problem where Chinese partners strongly influence HR policies and transferring employees from state enterprises to joint ventures can be difficult because it requires approval from the employees' old work union. In the reward system, new labor laws allow most companies to set their own wage and salary levels. As a result, there is a wide wage disparity between semi-skilled and skilled workers. However, these disparities must be balanced with the negative effect they can have on workers' interpersonal relations. Next is employee retention. It can be difficult to retain good employees because of poaching by competitive organizations. In response, many American joint venture managers are learning to take greater control of compensation programs in order to retain high-performing Chinese managers and skilled workers. In the work performance and employee management, local managers are not used to taking the initiative and are rarely provided with performance feedback in their Chinese enterprises. As a result, they tend to be risk-averse and are often unwilling to innovate. In turn, the workers are not driven to get things done quickly, and they often give little emphasis to the quality of output. At the same time, it is difficult to dismiss people. In the labor relations, joint venture regulations give workers the right to establish a trade union to protect employee rights and to organize. These unions are less adversarial than in the West and tend to facilitate operational efficiency. However, there's a concern that with the changes taking place in labor laws and the possibility of collective bargaining, unions may become more adversarial in the future. Expatriate relations. Many firms have provided little cross-training to their people and family. Education and health issues limit the attractiveness of a China assignment. Some of the major repatriation problems include limited continuity in international assignments and difficulties of adjusting to more specialized and less autonomous positions at home, lack of career prospects, and undervaluation of international experience. Management succession and the balancing of local and international staff at Chinese firms are also problematic. Some organizations have extended cross-cultural training to include training for family members, especially children who will be accompanying their parents. To training expats and their families, effective MNCs also are developing carefully crafted programs for training personnel from other cultures who are coming into their culture. These programs have materials they are specially designed for the target audience. Culturally specific guidelines are carefully followed so that the training does not lose any of its effectiveness. For example, inappropriate pictures or scenarios that might prove to be offensive to the audience must be screened out. Hands out and other instructional materials provided for all participants. If trainees learning a second language, generous use of visual and live demonstrations will be employed. Some of the specific steps that well-designed cultural training programs follow include: first, local instructors and a translator, typically someone who is bicultural, serve the pilot training program or examine written training materials. The next is educational designer then debriefs the observation with the translator, curriculum writer and local instructor. Group examines the structure and sequence, icebreaker and other materials that will be used in the training. Number four, group then collectively identifies stories, metaphors, experience and examples in the culture that will fit into new training programs. Number five, educational designer and culture and curriculum writer make the necessary changes in the training materials. And six, local instructors are trained to use the newly developed materials. After designer, translator and native language trainers are satisfied. Materials are printed. And lastly, language and content of the training materials are tested with a pilot group.
Okay, for the next slide, 11.0, cultural assimilators. The cultural assimilators has become one of the most effective approach to cross-cultural training. Program learning technique that expose members of one culture to some of the concept, attitude, role, perception, customs and values of another culture. These assimilators are developed for each pair of culture. For example, in MNC, going to send 3 US managers from Chicago to Caracas, cultural assimilator will be developed to familiarize the 3 Americans with Venezuelan customs and culture. In most cases, require the trainee to read a short episode of cultural encounter and choose an interpretation of what has happened and why. Choice of content of the assimilator is one of the major problems in constructing an effective cultural assimilator, is deciding what is important enough to include. Some assimilators use critical incidents that are identified as being important. Next, to be classified as critical incidents, situation must meet at least one of the following conditions. First, an expatriate and a host national interact in the situation. Second, the situation is puzzling or likely to be misinterpreted by the expatriate. Next, the situation can be interpreted accurately if sufficient knowledge about the culture is available. And lastly, the situation is relevant to the expatriate task or mission requirement. This typically obtained by asking expatriate and host national with whom they come in contact to describe specific intercultural occurrences or events that made a major difference in their attitude or behavior towards members of the other culture. These incidents can be pleasant or unpleasant or simply non-understandable occurrences. Next, validation of the assimilator. The term validity refers to the quality of being effective, of producing the desired result. It means that an instrument, in this case of the cultural assimilator, measure what it is intended to measure. Then the process is validated, making sure that assimilator is valid in the crux of its effectiveness. One way to test assimilator is to draw a sample from the target culture and ask the people to read the scenarios that have been written, choosing the alternative they feel is most appropriate. If a large percentage of group agrees that one of alternative native receives strong support, this scenario is used in the assimilator. After final incident chosen, they sequence in assimilator booklet and can be put online to be taken electronically. Similar cultural concepts are placed together and presented, beginning with simple situations and progressing to more complex ones. Next, the cost benefits analysis of assimilators. The assimilator approach to training can be quite expensive. A typical 75 to 100 incident program often requires approximately 800 hours to develop. Assuming training specialist is costing the company $50 an hour including benefits, the cost is around $40,000 per assimilator has been constructed. This cost can be spread over many trainees and the program may not need to be changed every year. MNC that sends 40 people constructed paying only $200 per person for this program training. In the long run, the costs often are more than justified In addition, the concept can be applied to nearly all cultures. Many different assimilators have been constructed, including Arab, Thai, Honduran, and Greek. Most importantly, research shows assimilators improve effectiveness and satisfaction of individuals being trained as compared with other training methods. Okay, next, positive organizational behavior, POB, positive internal traits of the leader along with factors tend to lead to consistent positive behavior. Positive organizational behavior defined as study and application of positively oriented human resource strength and psychological capacities that can be measured, developed, and effectively managed for performance improvement in today's workplace. Positively in the workplace has been connected to employee satisfaction. Positive environment consists of many layers. In order for an organization to be the most efficient and innovative, must have positive traits, states, and system in order to promote positive behavior. Positive trait consists of conscientious emotional stability, extroversion, agreeableness, openness to experience, core self-evaluations, and positive psychological traits. Positive state domain specific reaction and behavior may change depending on environment. Researchers have shown that other states are self-efficacy, hope, optimism, resiliency, and psychological capital. Finally, positive organization focus on selection, development, and management of human resources. This positive approach attempts to match employee skill and talent with organizational goals and expectation. When employees treated well, they will be motivated to give back to institution. Furthermore, altruism, conscientiousness, and courtesy will be inadvertently emphasized. For example, description above is culturally specific. That is, what seem to be in positive internal or external factors in one country may not be the same in another. Human resources are essential to an organization, no matter its location, and MNC should do all they can focus on the power of human capital to drive organizational success. So, I think that's all from me and my group. Thank you, everyone.